Discussion on the state of the Democratic Party from the eyes of the next generation. Katie Matheson and Eric Bigger are millennial Democrats here to discuss their thoughts on the party now and the road ahead. Great to have both of you with us. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Let's start off with the national level. Katie, let's start with you. How do you define the current state of the Democratic Party across the country?
I mean, the Democrats have the trifecta in D.C. They have the White House and they have both chambers in Congress, so I would say they're doing quite well. The president, President Biden, unseated an incumbent and won the election with the most votes of any president in the history of the country. And they just passed a $1.9 trillion stimulus that has got something like 70% support across the nation. And it's putting $1,400 into the pockets of qualifying Americans. And it could cut childhood poverty in half. So I would say so far they're doing pretty well.
Eric, your thoughts on the state of the Democratic Party?
Yeah, I echo what Katie said. We built a coalition nationwide that was able to turn out more people than have ever turned out before. The nation as a whole came together both in support of Democratic policies and in opposition to a Trump agenda that for 4 years had been pretty difficult for a lot of people to be able to deal with, and put us in a position today. We're controlling two houses of Congress, and the presidency with a bit of a mandate puts Democrats in a really good position going forward.
Yeah, no doubt nationwide turnout was very high for Democrats, but let's talk about the road ahead. How do you keep them coming out in the future? Katie.
I would say, Democrats nationally have some institutional struggles that make it harder for them to compete on the national level. And so what the road ahead looks like is continuing to make sure that every person, regardless of their race, zip code, or income, can vote, that they have the right to vote. That has been a big struggle for the history of our country. And also continuing to reach out to people across, like I said, race, zip code, and income. Make sure that the party reflects the people, because ultimately that's the point of parties, is to reflect the will of what people want.
Eric, your thoughts on the road ahead and how you continue to get that type of turnout?
Yeah, we're at a turning point right now, and it's going to be difficult for Democrats going forward because we're not really a functional democracy right now either. There's a lot of struggles with the Senate, with the filibuster, with the Electoral College, with gerrymandering, redistricting happening across the country this year. It's going to be really, really tough to be able to predict what's going to happen in the next 2 or 4 years. But I'm looking forward to the party putting together a slate of really good candidates because we've got the time, we've got the momentum right now to be able to do something special.
I want to get your thoughts on this last presidential election. A lot of candidates in the mix, some that are considered more progressive and further left, fell off as it went, and it went to President Biden, who, when you take a look at the field, was considered to be more moderate. Why do you think that happened, and will that continue to be the trend for the party in the future? Katie.
I think that Biden has a long history of doing this work, and ultimately he was able to build coalitions, which again is what we've said is the road forward, is building coalitions across, with folks who have traditionally not been involved in the political process. And I think that that is the road forward for any candidate who wants to succeed on the Democratic platform.
All right, Eric, your thoughts on that?
Yeah, despite the broad spectrum of beliefs in the primary, the party has coalesced around President Biden to a remarkable degree, and he's putting forward an agenda that is, one, delivering for working people and everyday Americans, but two, is really starting to be forward-looking for policy proposals going forward that are supported from liberals to moderates to conservative Democrats across the spectrum.
Okay, let's turn our attention now to the state level, where there is a much different reality for Democrats than what you just spoke of on the national level. There's no easy way to put it other than Democrats have really struggled statewide in the state of Utah. You have to go back to the 90s to find a candidate, a Democratic candidate, who won a statewide election. Why is the party struggling so much statewide, Katie?
There's culture, there's tradition. I think a more important question is what will the Republican Party do, which is, it's a supermajority Republican state. What will they do to continue to have the support of a very quickly changing and growing state. Traditionally, Democrats on issues such as Medicaid expansion, medical cannabis, fair redistricting, and another array of issues have, you know, been supporting what the people support. Mm-hmm.
Let me ask you something on that, though, real quick, Katie, because that was a big rally cry. You know, take a look at these lawmakers that made changes to the will of the voter, yet for the most part, we saw the same result.
Right. So I think that 2020 was a little bit of a special election. It turned out a lot of voters that normally don't or weren't turning out, you know, partially because it was a presidential election, but also because of the force of personality that was on the ballot. So I think that we have to look at this not just in one election, which is the tendency, but as a whole. Like, where is Utah growing? And yes, there has been ebb and flow with the Democrats' success in the state. But I think what Democrats need to do going forward is connect on values, of course. You know, you care about families, I care about families, and here is the policy solution. Mm-hmm. And two, the reality is, I mean, even the chair of the Utah GOP has said that Utah will change and will become a purple state in the coming decades. So I would love to see a Republican and a Democratic party that both support what the people want and fight over the policy that way, instead of one party that supports what the people want and one party that is trying to hold the people back.
Okay, Eric, your thoughts on the struggles statewide of the Democratic Party?
Yeah, I mean, the struggles are nothing new. Democrats have figured out ways here and there to chip away at the mountain, but the most important thing is to find good candidates that represent their district. This fake dichotomy between progressives and moderates, that's irrelevant if it doesn't have anything to do with the district they live in, the people that they represent specifically. And as long as the party can focus on recruiting good candidates in competitive districts, I think there's a lot of gains to be made throughout the state. Changing demographics and redistricting are always going to be X factors in the calculation, but I think we're doing really good at recruiting new and up-and-coming and thoughtful new candidates in the party.
Yeah, I would say that both the candidates for governor and an attorney general were very strong in the last election, and of course we know what the result was there. Eric, I want to dig a little more into what you just said, though, and the difference between extreme and moderate. I mean, it is an issue. So moving forward, is it going to be more effective for the Democratic Party to take more extreme policy stances or more moderate ones to bring in more support statewide?
Look, the Democratic Party is the party of ideas right now. And I think democratic ideas, democratic values are universal. Progressive, moderate, it doesn't matter. People want universal childcare. They want to be able to have health care for their family. They want to be able to see incarcerated members of their family and know that the criminal justice system is working for them and that we exist in a society that values racial justice and equality and equity more than anything. Messaging is the thing that we struggle on from time to time. It's how you actually say that. And when I say you need to match to your district, a lot of that's just about how you say it, not necessarily what you say, because there is consistency in the party. We're a big tent, but we have some legitimate ideas on how to improve both the state of Utah, both locally, and as a national party.
All right, Katie, your thoughts on extreme ideas versus moderate and how that will bring people in down the road?
I totally agree. I think that it is a false dichotomy. I think that what you need is an elected official that represents their district. The representative who represents Salt Lake City should not be the same representative, same type of ideology as represents, you know, someone necessarily in Provo. And so folks who represent the interests of the people that they represent is a huge deal. And I also agree on messaging. We should be connecting on shared values. And through that work, we can also stop being, I think, sometimes perceived as the party of the counterculture in Utah and instead be perceived as what we really are, which is the party of leadership, the party of the future, and the party of ideas.
All right, Katie, you already brought up your thoughts on this swinging to a purple state. Eric, do you believe that that can happen in the future?
Absolutely. I mean, we like to say we're chipping away at a mountain with a spoon from time to time, but it's inevitable when one party is able to bring up pro-family ideas and policies, and the other party seems to be mired in culture war as much as they can. We talk more about cancel culture than we do about childcare, and that's unfortunate for the residents of our state, but there's opportunities there for Democrats with good ideas to be able to break through and make a difference in elections.
All right. Very fascinating conversation. Appreciate both of you being here. Thanks so much.
Thanks.
Thank you.